Hello, all. It's Devora Krasnianski here from Adai. I'm working with the Crown Heights Jewish Community Council and Shalom Task Force, and our objective is to bring more awareness to areas of Shalom Bayis and domestic abuse. And so we've done several programs as far as education and awareness and support. So if you have any questions in those areas of Shalom Bayis and or domestic abuse, you can send us an email at info@adaiad.org. That's adaiad.org. Also, you can check out our previous workshops that are the recordings are at adaiad.org/path-events, and there's several other resources on that website, so you can check that out as well. Tonight's call is a very important one. We recently did some work with the Rabbanim and college teachers, Revitins, lesson teachers, etc. And many of them are, we're working really hard as far as helping them understand the issues of Shalom Bayis and domestic abuse. At the same time, they have requested that we provide some information to the general public about how they can be helpful in helping the Rav help them. So that's what tonight's talk is all about. And we're very grateful that Rabbi Shais Taub will be presenting for us today. And so we'll just jump right into that. So hello, Rabbi Taub.
Hi there. Thank you. Thanks for having me on this important call. God willing, our conversation tonight will help some people.
Yes, Hashem. So you are the Rav. You kind of counseling. You'll write several wonderful articles in the Ami magazine. You're also a relationship coach and a rabbi. So you work with a lot of different cases and a lot of different people, and then you also work with other rabbanim as well. What would you say is the most important thing that rabbanim hope people would know when they come to them in issues of Shalom Bayis?
Wow, okay. That's a good question. Most important. Well, I'll tell you an important thing, a very helpful thing. Maybe I'll phrase it in a metaphor, in a mashal. Imagine it's Erev Shabbos, and you call a Rav, and you say, it's an hour before Shkia, and I'm at the hospital, and there's a medical procedure that it's not life-saving, but it's a medical procedure, so the doctor says I'm supposed to have. So I want to know, should I have it before Shabbos? Well, okay. That question might sound innocent, but that's really not a question for a Rav. That's really a question. Until you've given more information, you haven't really asked the Shaila. Because, first of all, I don't know. Are you saying that the doctor says you have to have it? You didn't say the doctor says you have to have it. Are you saying maybe that the hospital is saying it's more convenient because of scheduling to do it right now? So basically, that way that we formed the question, really, you're asking it up to do the impossible, which is to tell you what the halacha says about a situation without really knowing the situation. But imagine if you call up and you say, you call up an hour before Shabbos and you say, I'm at the hospital right now. There's a procedure that I should get. The doctor says that it doesn't have to be done now. It could be done any time in the next few months. It happens to be that there's an opening right now. It will definitely go into Shabbos as we start. I'm wondering if that's permissible or not. Now you've asked Mishaila, because you've told the Rav what the doctor says. You've told him what the doctor's recommendation is. You've explained the parameters. Is it something that's necessary to have done now, or is it just something that's convenient to have done now? And now the Rav can give you an answer about Hilchos Shabbos. So that's a mashal. Imagine you call up the Rav and you ask a question which really doesn't have a clear black and white halachic answer. And what you're really asking is for advice. Now, You can ask Godel for advice. By the way, that's another thing we should talk about when to clarify. Are you asking for a psak or are you asking for advice? It's another thing. It's another subject, but I don't want to get off this train of thought. My point is that you would be asking a better shaila, a shaila the Rav would have a better chance of answering for you if you call up and you say, I've been in touch with a mental health professional. Mental health professional is recommending such and such. In fact, they say it's very important that I do such and such, or whatever the words are that the mental health professional tells you. And then the Rav can answer whether or not a Jewish person in your situation is allowed to follow that advice. In other words, you're allowing the Rav to do what the Rav can do, which is to tell you, is this mutter or asur, kosher, also things like that of that nature. Conversely, I want to sort of point out the other side of the same coin, is sometimes people, they go to a therapist, let's say, and the therapist recommends something. And the truth is that it's not something that you're allowed to do. Now, it's not the therapist's fault for recommending it. It's not their job to know your religion, even if it's a Jewish person. It's not their job to be a rav and to know dinim. So let's say a therapist suggests something, and it's not permissible to do. So you ask a shaila from a rav, can I do this? And they say, you know, under your circumstances, yes, or no, or whatever it is. And then you can go back to a mental health professional and say, you know, actually, this advice, I'm not allowed to do it. As a Jewish person, I'm not allowed to do it. And that itself will actually help you in the therapeutic process because if it's a good therapist, then they'll work with you, okay? Obviously, you know, we're going to have to work within your value system, and that's going to help you succeed in life. I'm just saying, even from a secular point of view, a therapeutic point of view, you're not going to help somebody succeed in life by having to not be true to their own values. I'll also add, from a spiritual point of view, there's no way to ever find happiness by going against Hashem's will for us. And the way we find out Hashem's will is through the Torah, and the way we clarify what Torah says is by asking it of. So I guess my point is, you asked me for the most important thing to know. To sum it up, what I'm trying to describe here is sort of somebody who is working using all the resources that are available. So just like in the mashal I gave you, you know, I'm telling you what the doctor says. Now I'm asking the Rav, what do you say about that? What does the Rav say, the Torah says, about what the doctor has told me? Then you're giving the Rav a chance to be able to actually make an informed decision. So the same thing is, if you're in a situation where you're really confused, where you don't know what to do, when you're going to the Rav, you should already have guidance from a mental health professional, and then the Rav can tell you if this is something that's fit for a Jewish person. Okay, but don't put it on the Rav to have to figure out all those things that really you're asking for them to do. It's like asking them whether or not I should have a medical procedure without telling them what the doctor says first. Let them know what the professionals say, and then the Rav can tell you, what does Judaism say? What does Torah say?
Okay. So basically, I mean, the Rav is educated in Shulchan Aruch, and that's his focus and his forte, and not necessarily mental health. So sort of go to the Rav for what the Rav is for. But then you kind of also mentioned a little bit that people go to a Rav for advice. Can you talk to that a little bit?
Well, you know, that's true. What is a Rav? A Rav is somebody who's an expert in Shulchan Aruch, so they know Halacha. Now, it could be that in addition to asking a question of a Halachic nature, sometimes you want to ask a Rav advice, Hadracha, guidance in life, sort of like a Seluch Rav in the sense of a Mashpia. And it could be that a Rav is your Mashpia. It doesn't have to be, but you could approach a Rav in that type of role as well. But then it's very important to clarify, am I asking a shaila? In which case, I'm sort of bound to the decision that I hear. Or are we just having a conversation? Am I trying to get clarity from someone who is learned, from someone who is God-fearing, and I just want to bounce ideas off of this person and sort of have a conversation with them and find my way or find some perspective? But that should be clarified what the nature of the conversation is. And as long as there's, you know, that's clarified and everyone knows what kind of conversation we're having, that can be very beneficial.
That's an important point. So there are different types of Shalom Bayis questions and different ways to approach the Rav with those kind of questions. Can you describe the typical ways, typical types of questions that come into a Rav?
Well, yeah, that's a very good question. By typical, I'm not sure what typical means. If typical means the most common, most prevalent, the thing is that most people who are asking Shalom Bayis questions, unfortunately, probably have just human nature. They've waited until the situation is fairly aggravated. So when you're asking, you know, what's the typical shaila, generally speaking, it's the more intense or more serious questions that end up even being posed to a Rav. At least that's from my general awareness of what kinds of questions are posed. I mean, obviously, I don't never get a study here, and I can't give you. There are no statistics, and I can't tell you, you know, numbers. But just generally, from anecdotally, from what it seems like, what it sounds like. At any rate, so I'm going to qualify this answer by saying there are a lot of questions for a Rav that actually never even get asked to a Rav. Probably the majority of questions end up just not even being asked. But those questions, what we'll call typical Shalom Bayis questions, those generally have to do with a misunderstanding, with a clash of personalities, a lack of communication, and sometimes those types of situations can benefit a lot from an objective, learned, God-fearing individual who can act as a third party to sort of facilitate a conversation. So that's what I'll use the word typical, as you use the word typical in the question. So, you know, the typical sort of run-of-the-mill standard Shalom Bayis issues would be something where the Rav can act as sort of a guide to helping the couple reach a dialogue, reach an understanding. And, you know, sometimes it's, I saw in a letter that Rebbe once, the Rebbe said that it's known that a segula for Shalom Bayis is having a guest in the house, which might sound counterintuitive because it's a stressful thing to have guests, but in the context of the letter, what it meant was, when other people are around, you're a little bit, you know, you're on your best behavior, a little bit more inhibited, which is not a bad thing. Not a bad thing to be a little bit more on guard. You know, with strangers, we're careful to be polite, we're guarded, you know, we don't make a bad impression. Sometimes we become careless with the people closest to us. So if it's a standard run-of-the-mill type situation, which, by the way, I'm not minimizing when I say standard run-of-the-mill. I'm not saying that it can't be extremely stressful and painful for the people involved. I don't want to make it sound like, you know, it's a walk in the park. No, it can be something that's very stressful, very painful, but really all it requires is somebody to help facilitate having a clearer conversation, clearer expectations, you know, to broker some type of understanding between the two parties. And sometimes just sitting in front of a third party gets people to behave a little bit better or just to think a little bit more objectively. That would be the standard thing. And honestly, those are most of the Shalom Bayis issues that come up in the world. But like I said, most of those people just sort of take care of on their own, whether that's the best way or not the best way, I won't comment, but generally speaking, people just take care of those on their own, and they either go away or they don't go away, or, you know, people learn to live with it, or they, whatever. Then there's a whole other category. And then you're talking about really serious dysfunction. You're talking about a situation that's not going to get better, or it's not going to get significantly better by having a discussion, by having better communication. There's something systemically broken. And without putting on either of the spouses, you know, who's the cause of it, I don't even care to comment, because as far as I'm concerned, it's really irrelevant, because it doesn't matter which party. Everyone's just responsible for themselves. That's a point maybe that we can talk about a little bit later. But each person has to be responsible for himself or herself. But there are situations that, unfortunately, and this is not the most common, but it does exist, where you're really not looking for someone to help negotiate better terms. It's really like, help me, I'm drowning, I don't know how to live, this is killing me, right? And which leads me to another point. I think a lot of those situations, when people do call a Rav for help, when do they actually make that call? When the desperation becomes acute and intense. In other words, when there's some type of acute crisis, and out of desperation, you know, because people have pride, people have dignity, they don't like to talk about their personal problems with anyone, even with someone they trust. So, and we put it off, and we say, you know, I can deal with it, and then something happens, an acute crisis that's just unbearable, and then out of desperation, we make the call. And as we probably all know, objectively speaking, that we're not very articulate when we are desperate. We don't think straight, and for sure then, we don't talk straight. We're not even thinking straight, so we're not going to talk straight. So it would be a good idea that when a person does reach out and make this type of call, don't make it out of desperation. Don't do it because of an acute crisis. And if you're going to say, but something needs to be done, well, yes, but if it's that acute of a crisis, meaning it's a real legitimate emergency, then you don't belong calling it off. Then, you know, we're talking about, a real emergency, you call 911, if that's what we're really talking about. But if it's something that you can live with for another day, for 2 days, and you can make that call to a Rav when you're thinking straight and you're calm and objective, it's just going to be so much more productive. So maybe the advice to give would be, when you have that desperate moment, you might make a firm decision. You're going to have to call. Even if in a day or two from now you've rationalized it and you feel calm and say, no, you know what, I was overreacting a couple days ago, I don't need to call. Maybe write yourself a note and say, you know, dear me, I know it's 2 days from now already when you're reading this and you've calmed yourself down, but remember 2 days ago you really felt like you were dying. So we're going to call it off today. Not when we felt like we were dying, but just remember that there are those days when we feel like that. Does that make sense what I'm saying?
Definitely. Definitely. So we were talking about how there's the simple or typical, and then there's the dysfunctional. And sometimes the people come to a Rav and saying, I want him to change. I want her to change. Just you help me make her change. Can you talk to that?
Yeah. Well, just a general rule in life is that is not a successful strategy for anything. Not even in the healthiest of marriages is that a strategy. In other words, even if there's like really great communication and understanding and openness and respect, you wouldn't say, oh, our marriage is so solid and strong, I can now control the other person. In fact, to the contrary, if it's so strong and solid, nobody's trying to control each other. Now, I understand when somebody's acting erratically or out of control and they're bringing chaos into your life. So there is a gut survival instinct. I need to be safe. This person is causing chaos. If I can control them, I can stop the chaos. So I understand from like a very basic animalistic gut reaction, you know, that adrenaline rush, that panic. Like, I got to get this person under control. I understand that. But if we can step away from it for a second and try to be objective and try to be cerebral and think, you know, with a little mayor shaltal alayf. Even in the healthiest situations, you can't control other people's behaviors. So how much more so when you're talking about a situation that is out of control, even though it's quite understandable why the gut reaction is, I got to get this person under control. But that's not happening. That's never happening. It is a deeper level of self-victimization. What I mean by that is, let's say somebody's acting inappropriately toward you. Okay. So that can't be helped. I mean, all I can do is avoid that person or try to avoid them so that it can't happen the next time. But let's say I got blindsided. I didn't even know it was coming. And they mistreated me. Okay. That I couldn't stop. But I don't have free will over how they're going to treat me. But where do I have free will? I have free will over my own thought, speech, and action. And that's where I have power, when I'm using my free will, to choose my thought, speech, and action. The minute I'm choosing thought, speech, and action for somebody else, then I have no power. I have no power because I cannot. My free will is over my thought, speech, and action, not over somebody else's thought, speech, and action. So whatever the other person has done to me, that's one level of abuse I've suffered, which I couldn't, but that I couldn't do anything about it. I couldn't stop it. That's somebody else's choice. But when I assume the role of being responsible for another adult's behaviors, that's actually a type of self-victimization, and nobody has to do that to themselves. I know especially, and I'm not saying this with any hint of I'm not trying to, this is not a borscht belt comedy routine here. This is a real thing. You know, there is such a personality called the Jewish mother. And Jewish mothers are martyrs, and they have the entire weight of the world on their shoulders. And this is a real thing. And this is not. When you begin to take responsibility for another adult's behaviors, you take away all of your power, because your free will extends to what you're going to do. Your free will does not extend to what you want others to do. So once you start putting any amount of energy toward that, you are taking away your own power. You are depleting yourself, exhausting yourself. So the way to get back your power, get back your energy, is to focus on yourself. Now, what does it mean to focus on yourself? You have to be careful when you say that, because a lot of times, especially if somebody has been so just demeaned and put down, and they're used to hearing those types of real negative messages about themselves. So you say, you know, put the focus on yourself. Oh, I heard what you said. That means I have to take the blame. No, that's not what we said. Focus on yourself does not mean take the blame. Not at all. Focus on yourself is sort of like what it says in Pirkei Avos, what Hillel said. In ain ani li mi li. I have to take care of myself. And it's interesting, by the way, the Bat Zanura, the Rav, probably the quintessential Pirush HaMishnayos, says over there, li v'tikunosi. If I am not for myself means if I am not for my own tikkun, if I will not fix myself. What does it mean to fix myself? It means that I cannot depend on somebody else to make me feel okay. That becomes one of the traps, that I need somebody else to let me know that I'm all right, that I have a right to exist, that I'm worthy, that I'm valid. Now, nobody can give me that right to exist. No one can give it to me. No one can take it away from me. Only God can tell me that I'm worthwhile. And God tells me I'm worthwhile by getting me up in the morning and giving me my soul back. So putting the focus on myself means, you know what? I'm not going to say anymore that my life will be stable when so-and-so's behavior will be stable. I'm not going to make my success in life conditional on somebody else's behavior. My success in life is conditional upon my behavior. And this is in the same Mishnah. This is the third of the three teachings. We said the first of the three in Anili. The third of the three teachings is Im Layachshav Imosai, if not now, when? Which is essentially the question, when am I going to have a normal life? Well, I'll have a normal life when so-and-so acts normal. Well, that may or may not happen. Or, I'll give you a shocker, maybe they'll start to act normal and you'll find that your life has drama coming from elsewhere. Yeah, sometimes that happens too. So, but the focus on yourself just means really to empower yourself to say, here are my bottom lines. Here are my standards. Here are my values. It has a lot to do with boundaries. I don't know if you were going to ask about that tonight, about boundaries, but I think that's something. Can we talk a little bit about that for a second, about the idea of boundaries? I think boundaries are something that are often misunderstood. A boundary is not a threat. A boundary is not, I'm drawing a line in the sand, you know, and I dare you to cross it. That's passive aggressive, and it doesn't work. Remember, a boundary is not when you tell somebody else what they've got to do. If you're telling them what they've got to do, you're disempowering yourself because, again, you're trying to use your free will to choose somebody else's thought, speech, and action. So you've made yourself a victim before they've even mistreated you. Just by disempowering yourself, by trying to assert power where you don't have it. So a boundary is not a threat. A boundary is not, you better do such and such. A boundary is, I'm going to do such and such. In fact, you don't even have to tell somebody what your boundary is. You can just know for yourself. Oh, yeah, that thing, that's not okay with me. I'm not okay with that. No, I will not expose myself to that, and I will do, and you can make up a plan. I will do such and such to remove myself from the threat of that if that is the situation. Now, you could express the boundary to someone else if you feel it's safe. You could do that. Give them a heads up. Oh, by the way, if such and such happens or you do such and such, which I'm not daring you to do or not do. I'm not threatening you if you do it. I'm just letting you know, heads up, here's going to be my response. And you could share that. You could share a boundary and say, this is going to be my response. Sometimes it's not safe to do that because it is taken as a threat or a provocation, even if you don't mean it that way. But my point is that for clarity's sake, for your own clarity, it's good to know that a boundary should never be phrased in your mind as what somebody else is supposed to do. A boundary is what I'm going to do. So, I mean, getting back to our main conversation, talking to Rabbanim, it's never very helpful to ask a Shaila about somebody else, right? Like, well, what should so-and-so do? Asking a Shaila for them, what they're supposed to do. Well, our Rav could even tell you, theoretically, yeah, this is what he's supposed to do. He's not asking me. So what do you want from me? He's not asking, or she's not asking. A good Shaila is always going to be about, what should I do? You know, I've been advised to do such and such, or not to do such and such. Is that okay? Is that permissible? Is that acceptable? Is that... So again, to return to the theme of the conversation tonight, but talking to Rabbanim, don't ask somebody else's shaila. You know, well, what's he supposed to do? What's he supposed to do? If he'll call me or she, if she'll call me, I'll tell him, I'll tell her what Titus is supposed to do, but then I'll call him. I can tell you what you're supposed to do. Is that distinction clear? Does that make sense?
You can only change yourself, and you can't really change anybody else. So we were talking about the effect of mindset to have about Shalom Bayis. And is there anything else you wanted to talk about in that area?
Yeah. Tell your story. Sometimes things are best expressed as a story. There's a chassidus from Ukraine that actually descended from the Ruzhiner Rav, from Yisrael Ruzhiner. It's called the Husyatna chassidus. During the interwar years in the 30s, this particular chassidus went to Vienna, Austria. And Vienna at the time in the 30s was a very cosmopolitan, very modern city. Not a very there weren't many Hasidic Jews there. So the Husyatna Rav was walking down the street, and somebody saw him and thought he looked very unusual. There was a reporter. The reporter asked, "Could I get an interview with this person?" So they said, yes, but you should know. You know, he's not just a regular rabbi or rabbina in German. He is a wunder rabbina, a wonder rabbi. She says, well, that's fantastic. I want to meet this wunder rabbina. So the reporter sat down with the Husyatna Rav and he asked him, they say that you are a wunder rabbina, a wonder rabbi. Could you define that for me? So the Husyatna Rav said, okay, well, first you have a regular rabbi and he controls a congregation. Then you have a rabbi who's maybe a little bit bigger than that. He runs a town, Shtat Rav. He controls a city. Then you might have a Rav who's even bigger than that. He's a chief rabbi and he controls the whole country. And then after that you have the Wunder Rabbiner and he controls himself. Controls himself. The hardest thing to do is to keep the focus on ourselves. But it's also the most productive and empowering. And if you can sort of compare it to the negative, what is the most insane-making behavior that you can do to yourself, I'm saying, is trying to get somebody else to act the way that you know they should, even if you're right, even if you're 100% right. So it's depleting, it's exhausting, it's insane-making. So when we keep the focus on ourselves, not only is it a way of being realistic, but it's actually a way of giving yourself strength back. It's a way of giving yourself power. So, again, getting back to the main subject, when you call a Rav and you ask a Shaila and you ask, what should I do? You're asking a strong question and you're more likely to get a strong answer. Or I might even say you're asking a more sane question, so you're more likely to get a sane answer. And conversely, you know, you can infer when you call up and you ask, well, what is so-and-so supposed to do? You're setting up whoever's going to answer that question, you're setting them up to give a weak answer, an irrational answer, because ultimately you can't tell one person what somebody else is supposed to be doing. So for the sake of your own clarity, your dignity, your strength, try to ask questions about what am I supposed to do? Or like we spoke about at the beginning of the call, I've been advised by a mental health professional to do such and such. As a God-fearing Jew, I want to confirm if that is the right thing for a Jewish person to do. Those are the types of strong questions that are going to get more of a clear answer.
So talking about working with the therapist and a Rav, can you talk a little bit more about what would be the ideal partnership working in tandem? How would that look?
Well, just remember that Most therapy, I have to be careful when I say this because sometimes people get they get upset before they hear the whole sentence. But most therapy, almost by design, is amoral. By amoral, I mean, well, moral means that the main criterion is it right or wrong? Immoral means right or wrong is not a criterion. I do what I like. And if I like something wrong, I do it. Amoral just means right and wrong isn't really the yardstick here. So when you're in a traditional, again, I'm painting with a very, very broad brush here, but you're not asking the therapist, is this right? Is this moral? Is this ethical? And it's not their responsibility to weigh in. I mean, obviously they're bound by certain ethical codes, but what I'm saying is as far as clarifying what your values are, you have to come to therapy with strong values. So somebody who has strong values and they come to therapy, a therapist can help you to be successful in your life as defined by your value system. But if you come to therapy and you don't have a strong sense of your values, then how are they supposed to help you be successful? I mean, they might help you reach some type of success, but success is very relative. There's many, many definitions of success. But to be successful within your value system in a way that is true to your beliefs and your morals, they can only help you do that if you come with a coherent and cohesive sense of morality and values. Part of having a clarity of values as a Jewish person is to be in regular contact with the Rav. That's part of what, in other words, let me say it like this. You don't just call it off to find out what Jewish values are. One of the Jewish values is calling it off. So the fact that you have that person in your life who is your Rav, who made a tzedek, a halachic guide, made a hero, that itself is a basic Jewish value. So just like, if you had a contractor in your house and you wanted to stuff up a window and you would say, oh, hold on a second, I think according to Rabbi Yehuda HaChassid, you're not supposed to stuff up a window, let me call it off. Right? You call it off about stuff that comes up. The same way, you know, you're dealing with a mental health professional, something comes up, it's not their responsibility to know whether it's permissible or not for you. They say, oh, that's a great idea, hold on a second, let me check it out with my Rav. So that's sort of, you know, you're asking what does that look like, having both of those resources in your life? That's a little bit, I'm trying to illustrate what it might, how it might look like in your life.
So then I'm just extrapolating that it might be useful to ask a Rav for a recommendation of or a referral for a specific therapist who he knows.
Absolutely.
And he can work with.
Oh, yeah. That is a great idea. You have a referral. You have a recommendation. That is the best. Now, a Rav might not know, and that's okay. They don't have to know. But if you have a referral, that's a fantastic thing. And the truth is that, you know, if people were to ask their Rabbanim who's a good therapist, even if Rabbanim didn't know necessarily the answer to that question, or if some didn't know, if that became a question people were asking, Rabbanim would know. And then there would be a lot more of a consistency in other words, what I mean by consistency is, a lot of times it's like two totally separate parts of somebody's life, and it's like, you know, I'm getting mixed signals and I have to sort them out. Okay, it is your responsibility as an adult to sort them out, but wouldn't it be even better if there were less mixed signals because everyone was on the same page? So, yeah, that's a fantastic idea, a fantastic right. recommendation.
So then moving along, is there any other advice from Rabbanim? Anything that can make such conversations even more productive?
Well, there's a huge tip, but it's not something you can go out and do today. You can't go out and do it right now. It's probably the most helpful tip, actually. The most helpful thing you can do But it's a long-term investment. And that is that you have to have your Rav. Your Rav means the person you call about all types of shilas. Person who knows you by name, knows your life, knows all aspects of your life because of the shilas that come up, whether it's in your kitchen or in your finances or in chinuch. So when you ask a Shalom Bayis question, especially Shalom Bayis questions being very often the questions that we're most ashamed of asking or most uncomfortable asking, if you have a rapport already, first of all, there's many assets to having a relationship and a rapport with a Rav, but one asset is it breaks through so much of that uncomfortable, awkward, that all the resistance that a person might have to calling, if this person knows you, that's first of all. Second of all, as I'm sure we all know, there's not one black and white answer for every shiloh. It depends. It's not a joke. I mean, halacha is nuanced. The application of halacha is nuanced. And what is a proper ruling in one situation is not a proper ruling in another situation. When you call up a Rav anonymously, and I know a lot of times there's a lot of shame involved, and so, people, dafka, they want to call anonymously. But let's say even it's not anonymous, you just call up and you say, here's my name. Now, the Rav doesn't remember the last time you called, doesn't remember the last shiloh that you asked. How nuanced of an answer are they even capable of giving you? So you're going to get a more nuanced, more fitting, more appropriate answer in every aspect of your life, not just Shalom Bayis, but especially in Shalom Bayis, if you have a relationship with your Rav. Now, I want to make it clear. I'm not talking about making sure that the Rav likes you so they'll be on your side. And I'm for sure not talking about finding a Rav that your spouse is talking to and convincing the Rav that your spouse is wrong. That's for sure not an approach. We never gain by putting somebody else down. So that's for sure not. And I'm not even talking about building ourselves up that the Rav should like me and think I'm a good guy and trust me. I'm not even talking about that. Not at all. The Rav doesn't even have to like you. They don't have to like you. The Rav's not your friend. I mean, they don't have to be your friend. But what it means is they know your life. They have some clue about various factors in your life, and therefore when you ask a question, they're in a much better position to give you advice that is applicable to you and applicable in a specific way. So, the first thing that a young couple should do, really, when you become an adult and you grow up, and, when you're a kid in your parents' house, so the family Rav is the family Rav. But you become an adult, you have to know who's your Rav. You have to develop that relationship. And you're going to say, but I can't because it's so hard to get through to them. There's a certain truth to that, yeah. But if you're in the same boat as all the other people who call just when things, it's 11 o'clock at night, the night of Bikas Chometz, and I have a shiloh about Pesach. So that's right, get in line. There's 1,000 other people in front of you. But if you're somebody who has a regular relationship with the Rav, then it's a different, and again, it's not favoritism. It's not like, oh, this person, I like them. It's not that they like you. It's just, I'll give you an example. Totally might sound far afield, but just to exercise our brains here. Imagine a situation where there's a shliach, there's a Chabad house, and half an hour before Shabbos, there's a guy who calls the shliach's personal cell phone, and he's got a question about a new crock pot that he bought. He has a question about Bishul, Hatmana, whatever it is on Shabbos. The new crock pot, it's half an hour before Shabbos. Who is this guy? He sponsors a Kiddush twice a year. He comes to Minyan once a week. And he goes to the Shliach's Tanishir. Now he's going to call up. And he's going to get a totally different answer not just totally different answer, totally different treatment than, let's say, some guy who's driving through, he happened to end up in this particular town for Shabbos. He's coming with his RV. He's parking his RV in the parking lot for Shabbos. And a half an hour before, he calls up the Rav, or he calls up the Shliach, and he has a Shiloh. It's not a question of favoritism, not a question of who I like better. It's a question of, you know, I don't even know where to begin. I don't know you. I don't know your situation. So it's just a good, it's good practice. It is just a general tip for successful living as a Jew. Have the person, have the Rav in your life who knows you, who knows your questions, who knows aspects of your life because of your questions. Again, this is not chanifa, it's not flattery, they don't even have to like you, but they just have to know you and know your situation, and you're going to get a totally different treatment. It's not about getting them to like you. Again, it's not buttering them up, it's not flattery, it's just they should know who you are. You will get a totally different response than if you are this. I mean, they're going to be compassionate as they can be, but I don't know you. What am I supposed to tell you? It's very, very difficult to give guidance. So just, that's a very, very generally helpful tip for everything in Judaism. And I think I'm going to add. Let's say we're talking about a situation that is extremely dysfunctional and that is truly abusive. And again, I want to just clarify, not all Shalom Bayis situations are truly abusive. Not most Shalom Bayis problems, it's the minority. But in the situations that are like that, in the minority of situations that are like that, it is very, very common that the person who is on the receiving end of the abuse is being systematically marginalized from life, from a support system, from a reality check. In other words, your world becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, and you have less and less opportunity to even find out, is this normal? I don't even remember anymore. I don't even remember anymore if it's normal. I haven't spoken to a normal person in so long, right? Or I haven't spoken honestly and openly with a normal person in so long. If you have the Rav that you call regularly for every normal Shiloh, in other words, if you're on the phone with the Rav 2-3 times a month anyways because of simple things, meaning not my simple, I don't mean halakhically simple, but I mean emotionally more simple, things that are not as wrought with shame and secrecy, you know, questions about basa b'cholos and stuff like that. If you're on the phone with the Rav 3 times a month, with regular shilas that come up in a Jewish house, I guarantee you that you are far more likely when the right time comes or when the necessary time comes to also be able to speak with some confidence and clarity and some self-respect about those really emotionally difficult questions, because it's within the context of a greater rapport and relationship. So yeah, I think that's, If you don't have that relationship, it's not too late to start it. Start now. You're investing in the future. And especially if there's somebody who's thinking, well, I wish I had this advice 15 years ago, but my marriage is beyond repair and we're getting divorced anyways. Well, let me tell you something. Let's say there's somebody on the call who is in that situation. To that one person, what I would say is, trust me when I say, if you had a good reason to ask Shilas, whether you asked them or you didn't ask them, you had a reason to be asking a lot of Shilas during a dysfunctional marriage, trust me when I say you're not going to have less Shilas after a divorce. You're probably going to have more, just different Shilas of a different nature. So there's no situation where somebody should say that it's too late to invest in cultivating a relationship with a Rav. Start now. It is always useful at any stage in the game. And earlier you start, obviously, the better, but it's useful at every stage in the game.
Very important. So also one of the things that I keep hearing from when I speak to the Rav is about people are not clear and they're not forthcoming.
Yeah.
And either people downplay the situation or they don't convey the severity or... And then they get the wrong advice. What is happening there? I mean, the Rav, we labeled this article as the Rav is not a psychic. So what do the Rabbanim wish people would do when they do finally come?
Yeah, I mean, obviously you have to be clear. Obviously, you know, you can't be euphemistic and use Lashon Nekiyah. You got to say it as it is. But that's easier said than done, because you know every Rav that I've spoken to has said, "Yeah, I mean, I wish people would be more clear about these things." Sometimes, a Rav told me recently that a woman came to him, like years after a divorce, and said, "You know, there was an abusive marriage." And I said, "I didn't even know," and she said, "Well, I hinted to you, but I understand that you didn't get the hint." So, I mean, that's something that happens, unfortunately, quite often. So it's easy to say, like I said, easier said than done. Be clear. We all know that. The Rabbanim want you to be clear. You know you should be clear. And if you know that, then that's a 2-minute conference call. You can introduce me, I'll come on, and I'll say, everybody, be clear. And then maybe we'll give a tip like, write it out. That is actually a practical tip. You know, write it down. Write a script for yourself. But then, you know, so now we have a 5-minute conference call. And then, you know, we're done. We know we were supposed to be clear, and what else are we supposed to do? I think there's the body and there's the soul. So the body is what you're supposed to do. Be clear. That's what you're supposed to do. But then there's a soul behind that. And the soul has to do more with your attitude and your perspective that enabled you to be clear. So all the things that I've been speaking about tonight, focus on yourself. Develop a rapport with the Rav. Have a good mental health professional, and then clarify the progress of that therapy with the Rav, asking the right shilas to get moral clarity about the advice that's going on in the therapy. All those tips that will also lead to clarity. So I mean, it's one thing to tell everyone we got to be clear, but and then the another thing, if I'm just repeating some of the bullet points that I mentioned tonight, yeah, don't call out of desperation. Maybe make a resolution when you're desperate, you're going to call, but call when you are calm and articulate. Or like I said, if you're talking to a Rav 3 times a month anyways, then at one point, you know, you're going to be calling up with a bus of a follow-up question, and then, you know, whatever, it's going to be the right time, and you're going to say, oh, by the way, I have this other question you need to ask for a few months. And you're going to ask it, and you're going to ask it well and confidently and clearly. But, you know, ask clear. Like I said, it's easier said than done, but if we have the right attitude, the right confidence, which I know is very, very hard to... If someone is in an abusive situation, that's the hardest thing, is to get back your confidence. But, again, do what you can do to empower yourself. Keep the focus on yourself, your thoughts, speech, and action, your bottom lines, your boundaries for what you've got to do for yourself. And, you know, ask a shiloh like a mensch. You feel like a mensch, you know, here's what I'm doing. I'm checking it out with a rav. I want to make sure that what I'm doing has a stamp of approval, and that it's all kosher, and that I'm sticking with Hashem's plan. That type of attitude is going to lead automatically just to being more clear and more articulate.
Also, when I spoke to Rav, they said the one thing to tell them is it's okay to cry. We've seen people cry before, so don't hold something back because you're afraid that you're going to cry. And they usually have tissues. That's what he said. The tissues in the office.
Mm-hmm. That's a good thing to mention. Yeah, absolutely. You have to remember that, unfortunately, whatever you're going through, I don't know if this offers people comfort or if it actually is a frightening thought, but it's the truth. Whatever you're going through, and I know this is hard to believe sometimes. But somebody else is going through the same thing, and the Rav you're speaking to has heard this question before. So I know that when people are going through a dysfunctional situation, it tends to be a feeling of, if anyone knew my sick, crazy life, you know, they would be shocked. And what I'm telling you is, unfortunately, no, the Rav might feel bad, the Rav might be pained as a compassionate human being, but he's not going to be shocked. He's not going to be shocked. So give yourself permission to say whatever you got to say, even if it's an emotionally painful subject. Just say it. You're not going to shock anyone. You're not going to embarrass anybody. You're not going to embarrass the Rav by saying what you have to say.
Do we have a few minutes for questions that came in?
Yeah.
Okay. So should both the husband and wife come together to discuss Shalom Bayis?
So, you know, like we were talking before about, you know, typical type situations and then the dysfunctional situations. In a typical case, yeah, I mean, that's a very helpful thing when you're using the Rav as that objective third party to facilitate a better communication, better understanding. That's great. There are situations where one feels, and I'm not going to put a judgment on whether the feeling is correct or incorrect. I'm just going to say it as a fact that one feels incapable of going to the Rav with the other spouse. If you feel that way, if you feel that's your situation, you shouldn't deprive yourself of going to a Rav because you don't feel comfortable going with your spouse. You should go by yourself, and you should say clearly that you're not comfortable with bringing your spouse. And incidentally, I know this probably goes without saying, but we'll say it anyways. If you feel that it would be very not good for your spouse to know that you even went to a Rav, then you have to tell the Rav, I'm not coming with my spouse, there's a reason for that, and I'm asking you not to share with my spouse that I've been to you. That is very important. And yes, be very clear about that so that they understand. And if it's an issue of safety, then just say it. Say it clearly. Again, for my personal safety, I'm asking you that this conversation has to be in confidence. But part of the conversation with the Rav may be about why you can't bring your spouse. Talk that out. Let's explore that. Maybe the Rav will figure out a way that you can bring your spouse. Or maybe if the Rav speaks with you for a while, the Rav will realize why you can't bring your spouse and agree with you. Oh, yes, I understand. You're in a situation where you cannot bring your spouse. But that conversation itself would lead to a lot of clarity for the Rav and thereby enable them to give you a lot better advice. So either way, talk it out and you know, have a conversation about it.
So similarly, should you or can you bring an advocate with you, like a friend or someone who
certainly
knows
what's going on? You mean like emotional support?
Yeah,
you certainly can. You certainly can. The only thing to bear in mind about that is rarely, if ever, is the advice you need a one-time fix. I know we would like there to be like, okay, I should have called for years, and now finally after years, I make that call. And now I make that call, and finally I did it, and the hardest thing in my life, I made the call. Now I get the advice from the Rav. Ah, now finally I'm getting the help I need. Rarely is it going to really be like that in real life. Rarely is there just one thing that needs to be done, and it's going to change the whole situation. Generally speaking, you know, there's a lifetime of adjustments and maintenance, and it's not a one-time fix. The thing to remember is when you bring in emotional support, that's fine. If a person is an emotional support, what I've seen, though, is that somebody brings not an emotional support, but they bring someone to be their thinker for them. And then this person they bring to support them actually ends up being the one who is articulate about the situation. The Rav then is able to be articulate back, you know, pun him up on him, and then the Rav explains it very clearly, and they have a very, you know, clear conversation. But you don't have, you know, you the person who actually, it's your life, it's your situation, you end up not having a clear mahalach, a clear approach. So if all that were required were going one time to a Rav, and then the Rav says something, and then you hear it, and then life is better, then yeah, it would work to bring somebody to be your, to think instead of you. But generally speaking, it's about assuming a certain type of an approach. You have to understand that approach. So you're going to have to work on it and understand it yourself. So I guess maybe the one way to say it is bring someone there to maybe hold your hand, to give you courage if you're, you know, scared, if you're ashamed, and this person's presence gives you strength. But don't let them take over, and don't let them be the one who understands the situation and you don't understand it. It's important that you've got to be the one who understands the advice. And it's important that others understand you, not your surrogate that you bring with you.
All right. So when we talk about calling the Rav, is it better? Is it okay to have a phone call, or should it really? Is it better to come in?
It's fine to have a phone call. Yeah, I mean, I think this goes back to what we were talking about before, about having a rapport, having a relationship, that there's a context for it. If the Rav knows you and knows your life, because you're in frequent contact, then there's no harm in calling. Some people do better on the phone. It really, I don't know there's a hard and fast rule. Some people feel if it's very serious, I want to do it in person. Other people feel the opposite, that if it's something that's really emotionally strenuous for me to deal with, I'd rather not have to sit across from somebody. I don't think that's the most important thing. I think that if you have a Rav that you're in contact with, then even a phone call can be very effective. But that's the main thing. Have that overall context for the phone call.
If something the Rav suggests doesn't resonate with me or doesn't feel appropriate to the situation, can I mention that? Is it okay to question his advice?
Yeah, you should mention it right away. Yeah. Well, you said the word advice. Okay, so I think we touched upon this, but let's touch upon it again. I think we mentioned at the beginning of the call. Be very clear. Are you asking for a psak, or are we having a conversation? If you're not sure, you can restate it at various times through the conversation. That's fair game. You know, let's say the conversation goes on for 10, 15 minutes. You can actually ask and say, by the way, just to clarify, are you giving me a psak right now, or are we just having a discussion about ideas? They just tell me what you think might be a good idea. So, yeah, clarify that. And let's say you already hung up, or let's say it's the next day, and they gave you advice, and you're really having a hard time with it. Yeah, you can go back to it off and say, I'm having a hard time with it. You can even ask, why did you tell me that? You can ask them to explain it to you. Now, I just want to add, again, I know I'm harping on this, but if you have that rapport, when you call back the day after you just asked Shaila and had a long conversation, and you say, by the way, I'm having a hard time applying this. Could you explain it to me again, and can you tell me why you're saying this? You're just going to be more likely to get that answer that you're looking for if they know you. And again, it has nothing to do with them liking or disliking. It's not about playing favorites. It's just, if I know a person, I understand them better, I understand their life better, I can have more insight. I have more to share. I have more of substance to tell them.
This question is: we know we can't go rub hopping, but if I feel like the rub doesn't understand, can I go to another rub?
Yeah, but try to think of it not as changing the rub based on the shaila. I think we keep coming back to the same topic, and I guess I'm glad about it, because I think it's such an important topic about a relationship. Having a Rav is not dial a Rav. It's not like you call up American Express customer service to have the interest charges removed from your last billing statement, and they send you through to a call center in India, and you speak to somebody who doesn't know you, doesn't know your situation, never met you. If you have a Rav, you know, and knows you, the whole thing, you just see it from a whole different perspective. So therefore, let's say, I asked the Shaila, I asked many Shailas, I'm not comfortable with the answers, or I don't know, I don't understand the answers, I don't know how to apply it, or I'm emotionally incapable, or I feel that way at least, of applying the answers. So don't say, well, for these Shailas, I'm going to go to somebody else. That's a little bit like Rav shopping. But what you might say is, oh, you know, I've been seeing this doctor for 10 years, but I'm going to change doctor and go to another doctor. In other words, don't say that I'm going to, don't say I'm going to go to one doctor, I'm not talking about specialists, but I'm talking about like a general practitioner. I'm going to go to one doctor one day and go to another doctor another day. You know, people do that, by the way, the ones who are storing the prescriptions, the pill addict.
Yeah.
But you can't do it like that. Think of it as a relationship. Think of it as if you're really, really not getting guidance from this person, so then change roles. Don't change on a question-by-question basis. Change as, like, this is the person now who is my go-to person. Just important to note that if you do make that change, then you're going to have to catch up, just like you change doctors. So the old doctor has to send you your records to the new doctor. You're going to have to catch up the new Rav on things that the previous Rav had told you. If they had told you certain things to do or to not do, it's not like the slate gets wiped clean and you're off the hook for those things. You're going to have to tell the Rav, look, I used to go to Rabbi so-and-so. I was told to do such-and-such. You know, you have to clarify if that's something that is still binding or not. But the new Rav will be able to, you know, walk you through that. But the bottom line is, view it as a relationship. If you're really not comfortable with the answers you're getting from somebody, then that means it's not the Rav for you. It doesn't mean they're a bad Rav. It just means they're not the one for you. And you find somebody who does understand you and who you understand.
Some really, really wonderful, wonderful points. This is being recorded, so we can, and we will share the recording at adayad.org/past events, or you can email me for it. You can also check out all the other recordings. If you have any other questions on this particular topic, you can definitely send it to us, and we'll try to get you the answers. What we cannot do is really answer a very, very specific case. That is something that you'll have to talk to your own therapist and your own Rav. We're sorry we cannot get to every single specific case, detailed cases. Right now we can work on the macro level, not the micro level. So
yeah.
We're sorry.
And by the way, I just want to chime in based on that disclaimer that because of the nature of a conference call like this, almost by definition, it applies to no one. Anything that applies to everyone applies to no one. So, you know, consider these ideas, see if they apply to you, but really, you know, maybe a conference call like this can get the ball rolling, can get you to start thinking about a subject, but to really figure out what applies to you and what doesn't apply to you, that's going to be the work that you do with the people in your life who know you one-on-one.
And with that, thank you, Rabbi Taub. This has been great. And again, you can always check us up at adayad.org, adaiad.org. Thank you and good night.
Yeah, thank you.